Hello, good morning, good afternoon, good evening, or good night, wherever and whenever you are listening to this. We are back with our crypto adventure, and what an adventure it is, Billy Farrington, all the way in the UK.
Hello, how are you? How's life over across in old Canada town?
Oh, life is just grand. No complaints, especially with Halloween around the corner. Everybody's gearing up for the festivities. Huh?
My favorite time of year.
Oh, I bet you're very spooky at heart.
Do you know who what I'm going to go as this year?
If I had to guess, probably Jack the Ripper.
Sam Bankman-Fried.
Oh!
Yeah. No, I'm not really. But yeah, I mean, that could be a good Halloween. It was terrifying, right? So, I mean, I would be scared if I saw like a Sam Bankman-Fried clone walking down the street with a big frizzy hair and an FTX t-shirt and a backpack. Imagine that.
Well, considering we've been listening to him speak on the stand, you could probably imitate him pretty well between run-on sentences and not giving clear answers or even like 2-minute pauses.
Yeah, I mean, it's so funny. It's a real shame that this hasn't been televised like the whole Johnny Depp Amber Heard thing. I mean, it would have been just an absolute, imagine the memes that would have come out of it being televised. That would have just been epic. So sadly, we just have to deal with, you know, secondhand accounts of what's happened in the trial. But there has been some pretty robust coverage. And it's just so, I mean, I'm just reading from like the dialogue of some of the responses. So yesterday, to get people up to speed of what's happened, yesterday he faced prosecution. The jury was sent home as Judge Kaplan wanted. He didn't want. He wasn't sure what was going to happen in Bankman-Fried's testimony. So he sent the jury home to kind of do it behind closed doors to get an idea of what he was going to bring to the table. I don't know. It's all a bit weird. It's not something that usually happens. He was asked. He was asked from the prosecution if he thought that Alameda Research had the right to access FTX customer funds, which is like the crux of this whole litigation, right? Mm-hmm. And God, his response. I'll just give you a little taste here.
Please do.
I should preface this by saying I'm not a lawyer. I'm giving legal interpretation of, I'm not trying to give a definitive legal ruling on what is or doesn't say. I'm not sure that I were quite as least as I remember. It just doesn't make any goddamn sense.
You know when kids are caught in a lie, they cannot give a direct yes or no.
Well, that's exactly
what that is.
It's a whole page of just gobbledygook. I mean, it's just a load. One of the Unchained has been doing a good job of keeping us up to date about what's happening.
That's what I've been listening to.
Yeah, definitely. They've been so good. They've been doing a good job. And they called it apologetic, forgetful, and evasive. And I think that kind of just sums up Sam Bankman-Fried as a human being, in all fairness. Not looking great. From what I understand, he's actually going to face the jury today. And we'll see what happens with his testimony. But I think we're not surprised to see it not going very well for him. Nat, what do you reckon?
Yeah, I'm not surprised. Evasive is definitely what it sounds like to me. Like I said, when most people are caught in a lie, they can never give you a straight answer. And the writing's been on the wall with his former colleagues and friends and, you know, crazy housemates. It's done for him. It has to be done for him. And the worst part is that during his testifying without a jury right now, just to figure out the, I don't know why they would give him the option just to speak to a judge and everyone in the gallery that's basically in the courtroom without a jury, just to figure out what would be admissible and what wouldn't be, because this is the guy that's literally on trial. What wouldn't you want to have admissibles? To me, there's a couple things that I don't understand. Also, going back to when you have four people on within the trial as witnesses that have already pled guilty, and you still have to put SBF through the ringer. It's still weird to me, but you know, there's a means to an end here. So I'm curious to see how it all wraps up. But he began his testimony, SBF did, with discussing the use of FTX's encrypted messaging on platforms like Signal and Slack. Okay, Slack is more of a professional platform, but Signal, that's basically texting, and was basically alluded to SBF telling his employees, you're better off using those platforms instead of email so you can cover your tracks. Wow. So what wouldn't you need to have admissible within testimony like that? It's just so weird.
Yeah. I'm wondering if the judge was like, oh, I want to get a grip. I want to get an idea of how he's going to approach his rebuttal. Is he just going to make stuff up that is going to unfairly sway the jury? I think he just wanted to get a lay of who SBF really is before bringing him before the jury. But, you know, the judge could have, there's plenty of video footage of SBF, because let's not forget that after FTX collapsed and before he subsequently belatedly got arrested. I mean, remember that media circus that he went on? He interviewed every, you know, New York Times, CNN, every Twitter chat, you know, finfluencer that would have him. You know, he just did this absolute massive media tour trying to
60 minutes.
Yeah, everything. And I guess say what you will about him, he's been consistent. He hasn't changed his line of dialogue for better or worse.
I know, but you should know if you're the judge, you're sitting on this case, you should know exactly what you're getting yourself into. And by the sounds of it, you know, you saw the movie Space Jam, right?
Of course, not that I haven't seen the remake.
I would hope so. No. We don't talk about Bruno. We don't talk about the remake. But you know how oh my God, Michael Jordan loses, or no, all the big players, they lose their powers, right?
Yeah.
The way that SBF is on the stand for me also makes me think of maybe Carolyn Ellison losing her powers, because I think that out of everyone that's been on this trial and that has spoken on behalf of FTX and Alameda, she's been the most loopiest one on record. And I feel like SBF touched her basketball, took her loopiness, and has just been showing it to the world. And maybe because this guy now at this point, he's facing decades in prison if he's found guilty on, what is it? We got
7 counts.
Yes, 7 counts, 2 of them being fraud. I have it written here, but we'll find it eventually.
Money laundering and fraud are basically the main.
Yeah, 2 counts of fraud and 5 counts of conspiracy, which we've already kind of alluded to, the way he was talking about using Signal and Slack to avoid people's tracks, right? But here he is. I feel like at this point, the only play that you have is to make yourself look a little insane.
Yeah, definitely. I guess that's what he's attempting to do. Who knows what's going inside that head? I mean, there have been some interesting new revelations this week as well. One of the more incriminating things that I read was that he purported to have an insurance fund, right? As most banks or brokerages are supposed to have, you know, to stymie bank runs if and when they can happen. So he espoused the fact that FTX had an insurance fund to back up, you know, funds that could have, you know, got, you know, to make sure that redemptions could keep going. And it, apparently the number that he said of the amount of money that he said was in this insurance fund was generated from a random money random number generator.
No.
So he press a button, a random number would appear, and he's like, yeah, that's how much is in the insurance fund today.
Oh my God.
Yes. So it's just all these things that are coming out. I mean, it just keeps piling up the absurdity of the whole thing. I'm so upset it's not televised.
You're right. This should be televised. This is absolutely like Amber Turd territory. This is like crypto OJ at this point. And it's not as big of a deal as it should be. And even worse, I keep picturing googly eyes in his freaking afro. Like every time he's talking, I'm just like, who's talking right now? The hair or SBF? Because none of them make sense right now.
Apparently he shaved his head.
I can't see him without I can't see it without it.
Yeah. It's just not SPF without the afro, you know?
Nope. It is not. But here's another weird point. So it's going to be very interesting to see what happens today. So it would be Friday, day 13 of the trial, right, when hopefully the jury is let back in, and that way they'll have they'll be able to use whatever he says as evidence, right?
Yeah.
But here's a thing happening behind the scenes with FTX is that this week it was reported that assets from an FTX estate have been transferred to a Binance address.
All right.
Yeah, we don't know why. And I'll pull up the article here because it's looking like this estate has moved roughly $8.6 million worth of Ethereum, Chainlink, Aave, and Maker to Binance. And you got to ask, why is this happening? First of all, second of all, how does the FTX estate have this capability to be able to transfer funds? Wouldn't it be frozen? That's probably an answer for a different day at this rate. But at the same token, timing is probably on their side with the way Bitcoin and Ethereum have just been rallying for the last 2 weeks.
Sure has. It has been a really, really good October for Bitcoin, and that has fed down through the wider crypto space in general. I mean, looking at Bitcoin right now, it's up about, it's still up about, what, 20-odd% week on week, right? Now, there has, I mean, there has been a bit of a tailing off. It has, I guess it kind of hit a peak at around $35,000 US, and so we've seen a bit of a retracement, but regardless, I mean, just seeing all these massive green candlesticks over the past 2 weeks has been really, really strong on Bitcoin, and you know, there's obvious reasons for that. I mean, all this hype surrounding the exchange traded fund applications that apparently, you know, look like they're coming closer and closer to becoming a reality. And just as a recap for listeners, that is essentially the likes of BlackRock, Grayscale, ARK Invest, a bunch of others have been pushing, prodding the Securities and Exchange Commission for approval of their exchange traded Bitcoin ETFs, which would give investors the opportunity to trade Bitcoin on the traditional capital markets. It would just it would open up a huge amount of potential investor money into the Bitcoin market, and would be like a really good catalyst for price action. Now, it's still hype, it's still speculation at the moment because nothing has technically been approved, but it's just the hype on the back of that has really sent Bitcoin into a spin. It hit 17 month highs earlier this week, Nat. So it's a really, really strong period. I'm just wondering if there's going to be a bit of a sell-off now as people get out and take their winnings.
That you have a very good point. And you remember how last week we were talking about October, or the beginning of the month, we were talking about, I don't know too much about October, and we're really going to see it, but it's definitely like surpassed every expectation of what the rest of this year, at least this month, could look like. If it wasn't for the basically all the hype around the ETF applications, the spot Bitcoin and Ethereum ETF applications, I don't think we would see this.
Do you think there would have still been a positive October even without the whole ETF hype? You know, the end of the year generally goes well for Bitcoin. You know, historically, there's been that sort of Santa rally idea. And then obviously the halving event is coming up next year. So there are some positive catalysts. But, you know, still a high interest rate environment, still a strong dollar as well. So I don't know what would have happened. 100%, you're right there. We wouldn't have seen the amount of positive price action that we've seen. But I mean, just look at where it is. It's like about $6,000 above the 200-day moving average trend line. I mean, that's really, really strong. But at the same time, you need to think, ooh, is that a bit too red hot right now?
It's a very valid point. Like, how long can this be sustained for? But to your point, I don't think we would have seen anything worth talking about. Maybe we could have seen October end on a green note, with some gains, but nothing like this, because I feel like the macroeconomic environment is just way too volatile right now.
Oh yeah, definitely.
There's that, obviously, inflation and the recession talks, like Canada, this week, they just held for their very last meeting in terms of interest rates. They actually held it, which was expected at 5%. Mm-hmm. But it's also giving way to now the real estate market needs to adjust, and prices. We still don't know right now. It's actually looking more like a buyer's market. So I feel like everyone's got their mind elsewhere. If it wasn't for the ETF talks, that's just my thinking right now. That's just my thinking. Yep. But this is a good thing. And last year too was very quiet at the end of the year. Let's not forget that. That's why I feel like the momentum wouldn't have been as big. But the timing, like FTX moving their estate over $8.5 million worth of crypto, that's not a move that happened unconsciously. The ETF applications, not a move happening unconsciously because of this Bitcoin halving, because everybody has it circled. Meanwhile, when we do actually get to that in the spring, I would love to know, A, whether or not this has been sustainable and people have been holding on with diamond hands to be able to get that bigger payday in about 6 to 8 months' time. But when the halving actually happens, could we see the new all-time highs that everyone's projecting happening right away? Or would those be prolonged maybe a month or two to allow for macroeconomic factors and whatnot, and interest rates, inflation, recession, all those things piled on to at least catch up for more people to be like, I'm just going to not think about that right now and throw my money at crypto, as opposed to taking it all factored in and be like, yes, this is definitely going to be the move right now, regardless of what's happening.
Yeah, I mean, I guess it depends where the definition of Bitcoin, in my view, is always changing, right? Yeah. And I feel like the more recent narrative has been, Bitcoin is not something that will make you rich. It's something that can keep you rich, though. By that, I mean, you can park your money there. It's safe from taxes and all that sort of thing. So, don't quote me that. Where Bitcoin used to be this sort of like, you know, when pump, I want to make 1,000x returns. I mean, let's face it, that's probably not going to happen again, at least in the short term. So it's going to be difficult to make those insane returns that people saw like in history. But the narrative, from what I, you know, from my perception, has moved to sort of like a gold thing where, I can park my money here. It's a bit of a hedge against volatility elsewhere, and it's a relatively safe asset. So with that in mind, I would assume that some sort of post-halving rally would be a bit more sustainable as opposed to the short-term moonshot. And, you know, we saw what happened in the end of 2021 when it did moon and then absolutely tanked. So do we really want that to happen again? I guess, if you're savvy enough, you can, you know, get in and get out at the right time. But that's only going to be, you know, a small amount of people that are going to benefit from that. But if the longer term strength of this asset, I don't think this sort of short term post-halving pump would be very healthy in my view.
No, and I agree with you, because Bitcoin's just been around for far too long now.
Yeah.
It's past that phase. It's grown up now.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
It's in college. We're waiting for it to graduate next year and nice buy a house.
Nice growing up. What's happening else? What's happening elsewhere? I mean,
yes. Like, oh, I got you. I got the segue here. I got your segue. Oh, yeah. Okay. You mentioned those moonshots. And where do we normally see those moonshots? We see them with altcoins. Yeah, and especially with the way that Bitcoin is moving. My dear friend Ethereum has been following suit to an extent. Ethereum is up on the month. It's up about over 10%. And the last 2 weeks have been the best performance for Ether, over 15% in gains. What are we sitting at right now? Almost $1,800. Yeah. That's basically where it's been hovering around, right, Billy? Yes. But here's the thing, is that when we saw Bitcoin make those all-time highs of 69K, the altcoins were right behind it on its tails. And it would be beautiful If we could have another altcoin season again, wouldn't it? Wouldn't it? Just think about it. Just think about it. You have meadows, rainbows, butterflies, and lots of money.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of think we're in a different era now of separating the wheat from the chaff, so to speak, and far fewer shit coins and far fewer sort of notable pump and dumps. So, again, you know how much I like following Bitcoin dominance. We have seen that concentration of wealth in the Bitcoin as a benchmark cryptocurrency. And I think that in my prediction would be that trend will continue, and there will be a continued concentration of wealth towards the upper echelons of the cryptocurrency space instead of the more volatile and less the more volatile altcoin space that has not really proven its utility so much, so to speak. And I guess there's reasons for that, because when we saw that crazy pump at the end of 2021, where everything pumped, Bitcoin and altcoins, everyone had funny money back then. You know, there was all the stimulus checks and stimmies, and people had, you know, interest rates were zero. Some areas are negative. And the stock market was going haywire, and it was just the combinations of macro factors were just perfect for this rally in the crypto space. But I don't think we're in that situation. We're definitely not in that situation now, are we? I mean,
thank God,
rates have gone up and up and up and up and up.
Well, not that part.
Inflation is through the roof. People kind of just have less money right now, and I think they have less money to throw on speculative hype coins that, you know, that they did at the end of 2021. So I don't really see that kind of similar kind of altcoin rally that was seen in the past. But hey, who knows? I could be proven wrong, but that's just kind of my prediction, really.
Well, when haven't we been proven wrong by cryptocurrency in the past?
Yeah.
It happened already many times, and it's not the end of that. But you do make a really good point. When in 2021, it was like the stars had aligned. That you can't happen. I can't even like put into words how perfect everything was for all those rallies, Bitcoin rallying and all the altcoins rallying behind it. The world is just so different, and it's only been 2 years, if not or less. Isn't it so amazing? Like, you can look at a stock market, and, you know, every dog's had its day on the stock market, but nothing was like cryptocurrency. And, you know, it would be really nice, like, especially me, I have to top myself out of being super optimistic, because you just can't predict it. The stars had aligned back in 2021. The world has changed so much in 2023, heading into 2024. Lord knows what's going to happen now, going into the new year. Anything can happen. But at the same token, pun intended, the Bitcoin halving has the power to do just about anything. And maybe with Bitcoin's dominance showing, if you see some more sell-offs, you see the sell-offs that you think might happen with Bitcoin's rally, maybe people might be taking those gains and throwing them into other investments within the altcoin space to get even more return on their investment. That's kind of where I think. Like, I think beginner investors are savvy enough to know when to take the money and run. To an extent, like, it's not, you don't just need a chart to be able to figure it out. And people that can read the most complicated of charts still can't figure it out to a certain degree, right? It's still a matter of luck at the end of the day. And you still got to trust your gut. And it's just still so unpredictable. That Bitcoin halving can change everything. And I will leave you with one thing that I learned in my short and very educational investing career. the best line I ever got was from my stepdad, who's pretty knowledgeable in that space. Like, he got me into it during the pandemic when there was nothing to do, so I'm like, may as well learn
as we all did.
And he's like, just don't forget, the fat pig gets sent to slaughter. And I'm like, oh, and then something happened where I lost a lot of money, or could have made a lot of money and didn't pull the trigger. And I'm like, oh, I was that fat pig.
it was really I don't want to say amusing because, well, it kind of was amusing, but so many people got into the stock market and the crypto markets at that point when things were going through the roof and everyone had their stimmies. And I think a lot of these like new investors were like, hey, this is amazing. The market just goes up and up and up.
It's so easy.
It's free money. This is going to keep happening. Buy more. I mean, what can possibly go wrong? This is great. I'm just earning hand over fist day in, day. And the market just doesn't go down. 2 months later, kind of reality did come crashing down. And not just the crypto markets crashed, but everything crashed. 2022 was the worst year on record for the UK stock market, for like fundraisings and sort of globally, it was just an absolute disaster. So for those short-term investors, was not a good thing. I think the lesson there, Nat, and this applies to Bitcoin, I think, is being a short-term investor, can work, but it really cannot work. If you're in something, especially Bitcoin, I think you need to be in it for the long run, and you need to look at it as a long-term investment, because there are going to be these crazy year-on-year swings in volume. If you're serious about it, then I think you need to have a long-term investing horizon, or else you might get stung.
Right. And you also have to look at the altcoin space in a different light than you look at Bitcoin, because Bitcoin's big daddy. He's not changing, but he's also matured enough that he's going to take his own course for the most part. And like I said, still unpredictable. But when you look at the altcoin space, you can't look at it with the same lens, because this is a growing space that hasn't exactly matured yet. No. So there's a lot of changes happening all the time. And you also have to learn how to read between the lines. So if we talk about a potential altcoin season, let's look at the major altcoins and see what they're doing on a project, in the project space, or not the project space, as a project. How has it been growing? Where do you see this project heading in the next 5 to 10 years? And then that is how you gauge. That's how you have to learn how to gauge whether or not an altcoin season could be in the cards. So here's an example here, just to give everyone listening just a little smidgen of the kind of mindset, at least in my very humble opinion, that you have to look at altcoins if you're looking to invest. So judge the project. We're heading into Bitcoin halving. So everybody wants to capitalize, like the ETF applications and whatnot. But let's look at what they're actually doing. So not any huge gains happening across the board. But if we look at Polygon, for example, a huge altcoin project, they're rebranding. And they have been making moves all year long to gather big brands under their umbrella, with partnerships with Disney, Starbucks, you name it. They've been making the moves. Now they're rebranding their token. They're going to have a brand new token. It's going to change from Matic token to POL, P-O-L, like it's in Polygon. I
wasn't actually aware of that.
Yes. So they're making the moves to be more visible in this space, heading into a Bitcoin halving. Let's look at Phantom, who has been basically changing the game when it's coming to sharding, which is a whole new brand of technology for being able to make transactions faster, but also making the transactions a lot smaller to deal with, to be able to make them more scalable and quicker to happen and cheaper. So if we look at Phantom, for example, they have made a significant upgrade, and that was the words used, to their technology stack. They named it Sonic, LOL, love the reference. And Sonic is expected to accelerate Phantom's performance by an additional 65 times.
Where
do you ever see that in any kind of technological space? Not even the mobile phone space can do that. And then also just learning about what exactly are projects doing to simplify the process of launching network nodes. If you want to get into that space and generate income that way, where you're able to run the actual, help me here. If you're a node.
Yeah.
If you're a node, you're essentially validating the transactions, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And what is a project doing to be able to lower costs for customers and for users so that they can have more money in their pockets? And then you look at Solana, another big one, and they're probably, if NFTs come back, they will be another big player in the NFT space. They've been dominating altcoin inflows as crypto funds experience a fourth week of gains. So October has been good for a lot of altcoins, not just in terms of gains, the way that Solana may have been seeing it, but in terms of preparation.
My worry, and you're right, you can look at all these like really enticing projects and growth and sophistication of the actual underlying consensus models and the transaction speeds and scalability and all that. My worry is that it's still... there are still so many barriers for the average person on the street. It's not easy to get into the crypto space. You know, you got to deal with these wallets and phrase, a seed phrase. It's still really difficult to do. And it's arcane in some ways, or, you know, it's, you know, not everybody just kind of gets it. And even like someone like people like you and me who have been involved in it for quite a while, there's still things that are really hard to understand. And until that technological barrier comes down and lets your grandma or, you know, a friend on the street get involved in the space, not just in a buying and holding and hoping for pump, but also interacting with blockchain protocols and transferring funds and wealth and buying and selling products over the blockchain. Until those technical barriers come down, I still see issues with growth in the sector, because as it stands, it's still, you know, I think there's credence in the fact that a lot of these projects are, you know, a solution in search of a problem, right? But that's only because it is still just really, really hard for people to use. It's not user friendly, and that's something that needs to be needs to be looked at if institutional mainstream adoption is ever going to be a thing. That's what I reckon. Until that happens, it's still going to be in the shadows, so to speak.
You're right, it's not matured enough yet, and I think for me that's what makes it exciting.
100%.
Damn, right. Oof, what a way to put a bow on another week in crypto adventure land. Billy,
all right, yep, 100%. What's your weekend plans, Nat?
The plans I can tell you, or the plans that
you can tell me after. I want to hear the secret plan.
So I'm going to be playing in a Halloween slow pitch tournament. For people that don't know, like, I grew up playing softball. I played in college, and now I've retired and turned into a competitive slow pitch player. The biggest contradiction I've ever heard in my life. But anyways, a bunch of us are getting together. We're dressing up. Lord knows as what yet, because it's tomorrow. We still don't know what we're dressing up yet. But I think we're just going to be like a bunch of beer league has-beens and just getting drunk playing slow pitch. I think I bought butterfly wings, so I'm going to be a little drunk butterfly in the outfield. That's my plan anyways, playing slow pitch in the cold.
I might join you. I'll pop on a flight and come over to Canada and join you. It sounds like fun.
Oh dude, best money you'll ever spend.
All right.
All right, guys, everyone watching and listening, thank you so much for tuning in for another week of the Crypto Adventure with Billy and I. If you have any questions, if you have any points that maybe we hit the mark on or missed the mark, drop them in the comments. We want to hear from you, and we definitely want to be able to tailor our content to what it is that you want, you need, and being able to make sure that you guys are happy. So thanks for watching again and listening. We'll see you again next week.